So I probably should have said this at the beginning, but I'm not Pastor Jim. You might have figured that out already. Pastor Jim is on the conclusion of the men's John 17 weekend, and so we had planned a long time ago for me to come and pinch hit for him today here on this Sunday morning. What a remarkable and unprecedented time we're in the middle of in this country. I don't remember anything quite like it, and I don't know when we'll see something like this happen again. It's unprecedented, and so we want to go back on those slides to the beginning, all the way up to the top. I think times of stress, both personally and nationally, have a way of bringing out both the best in people and the worst in people. I had the privilege of being involved when Desert Hope first got started, and it was one of those times of high stress. And a handful of you who were around back then may remember that I suggested that you keep a phrase very close to you. And I'm going to suggest that this would be a time where we pull that phrase out again. This is an EGR time, an extra grace required time. Let's keep that in mind as we interact with one another, because it's a high stress time for everyone in our nation at so many different levels. But it's not only a high stress time, it's also an opportunity for the church to be the church for one another and for the most vulnerable among us. We have an extraordinary opportunity right now to be the church. When everything is shaking, Jesus remains unshaken. He's on the throne. I'm going to put a slide up for those who are watching this that's got our web address as well as my email address. And the reason for that, every Tuesday, our ministry is all about uniting the body of Christ. And we have a newsletter that's coming out. I've been bombarded with phone calls and emails over the last several days, including several folks around the city that are talking about some ways that as one city church, we can organize to be a blessing to our city. And so I'll share whatever we have by Tuesday in that newsletter. And if you're not already getting it, you may want to. So if you go to the website, you can sign up for the newsletter and see what God is doing in our city as the body of Christ gathers together to respond in this extraordinary time. Now, every time I preach here, especially lately, I've shared that you're kind of my second home church. You're my lead team. Messages that I preach, I typically preach first here. So another way of saying that is you're my guinea pigs. Let's just call it what it is. I'll often take a message that I preach here and then have the opportunity to share it in a number of other churches around the city. Once we decided to move to online for here today, I debated completely changing plans and speaking just to the context of where we are. But there's two reasons I didn't do that. The first is that I'm a guest, and I know that when Pastor Jim is back with you, he will want to address some of that context. And so that's really not my place as much as it would be for Pastor Jim to be able to share some of those things. But the other reason is that we're in the middle of this, we could call it a donkey-elephant war. And I'm sorry to say, not even the coronavirus is going to slow down the donkey-elephant war. It just gives us new material for the war. So I've got a book that I've been working on that's coming out in early May, end of April-ish, somewhere in there, called Peace Talks: The Good News of Jesus in a Donkey-Elephant War. And this message that I'm sharing this morning, I believe I'll have opportunity to share in a number of churches around town leading up to November especially. And so this is the first crack at it. I'm going to be touching on some main points in 7 out of the 10 chapters. Frankly, I'm not sure that's a good idea, but that's what I'm going to do anyway. So at the end of the message, I would love to get some feedback. Is it too much content to fit into one message? Anything like that would be really, really helpful. It's my best crack at it, but this is more a seminar than it is a sermon. So it'll be some combination of both, and we'll do the best that we can. We'll all just march through this time together. On May 9th, I say tentative seminar planned because everything that we're planning these days is tentative. Who knows where we'll be on May 9th, but as it looks right now, we're planning a seminar probably 9 to 12 in the morning, working with Francine Reinstra, who, with her Via de Dios ministry, J17 Ministries, will be working together, and that'll be an opportunity to take some of this, because how many of you have family members that, let's say it's a Thanksgiving, and you just dread, because you know somebody is going to say something political, and then the whole rest of the time is going to be extremely uncomfortable. Anybody else? There's some help for this. I don't say that theoretically. I say it very, very practically. It has changed the dynamics in my own family. I'm thrilled at the way that we're interacting with one another now, especially compared to how we interacted with each other a year or two ago. So there's some things that we can learn. That's what I want to share some of this morning, more in the seminar, and then the full material will be in the book when it comes out. So we can get better at this, and we can be the salt and light that Jesus calls us to be. You may have noticed Jesus didn't say you should be the salt of the earth. He didn't say you really ought to be the light of the world. He said you are those things. Now that's a good news, bad news message if there ever was one. Because what it says is we are flavoring the world. We'll just flavor it for better or for worse. We are showing the world a path. It's just a good one or a negative one. We're either going to flavor the world with unity or we'll flavor it with division. We're either going to sow maturity into those around us or immaturity. So let's do all that we can to be part of the solution instead of part of the problem. And church is no exception. Politics typically does not bring out our best selves. I want to take just a minute and go through some factors that are contributing to this donkey-elephant war that we're in. Arguably, many, many people have researched and said the country is probably more divided now than it has been at any time since the Civil War. And that's a scary, scary statement. There's several things that are contributing to that. This is the bad news part of the message. Good news is coming. Hang tight. One of those is our Western worldview. I shared a whole message on this. The Western worldview here at Desert Hope not too long ago. A Western worldview takes the whole and divides it up into parts. That's not all bad, but the bad news is the Bible is not written from a Western worldview. The Bible is written from a whole perspective, not the individual parts. And so we tend to look at things very individualistically here in the West. We tend to make things either or, when often God calls them both and. And so that's one of the factors. We view politics as an either or instead of a both and. Another message that I shared with you the last time that I was here is that we have this tendency to over-identify with secondary things. One of the clearest examples of that would be our careers. Whether that's as a homemaker or out in the professional world doesn't make any difference. If we've over-identified with our career, when something changes, we're lost. We retire and we don't even know who we are anymore. Or the kids move out of the house and what do we do now? We've over-identified with something that's not built to handle it. Well, I'm completely convinced we've totally over-identified with politics. It's the only reason that I can come up with for why we say and do some of the things that we say and do. We would never do that in other settings. Which leads to, there's a whole lot less friction in communication today in a social media and electronic world. How easy is it to just fire something off in an email and click send and then say, oh, I probably should have thought twice before I hit that send button. It is remarkably easy these days to communicate with the entire world. That has some blessing side to it, but it has a curse side to it as well. There's less friction in communication. And then I don't know if you're aware of this. My son helped explain it to me how it works. But social media algorithms literally feed us what they think we want to hear. Google does not just do an open search. It bases its results on what you've searched for in the past. It literally learns what you're interested in, and it gives you what it thinks you'll want. Facebook, all of the social media, they all work the same way. So we're literally being given more of what we've already done, and we don't have any control over that at all. It is a brand new world that we live in. Did you know there are 2.5 billion people actively posting on Facebook every month? 2.5 billion people. And the algorithms just give you more of what they think you're going to be interested in. Learned a new term in the research for this book, narrowcasting. You ever heard that before? We've heard of broadcasting and media for most of us, certainly the handful of us who are in the room, we're used to media broadcasting, where it broadcasts to a large audience, and the goal in that setting was to not do anything offensive. You want to not rule out any of your audience. Well, that's not the world that we live in any longer. Once cable news and other types of media became available, media intentionally now narrowcasts. It doesn't even claim to be broadcasting to the whole culture. It picks a slice and it shares the news stories that that slice is going to be most interested in. That's much more lucrative for advertisers because they know who they're advertising to. They know their audience. So we live in a narrowcasting world instead of a broadcasting world. There are foreign influences that have decided, this is just scary stuff. They've decided that the political division in our country is to their advantage, and so they are literally engaging in the social media world in order to fan the flames of our animosity. That's in the best interest of enemy nations. Just scary, scary world that we live in. You put all of that together, and we all live in echo chambers, meaning the voices that you hear sound a whole lot like your own voice just bouncing right back to you. And that's going to be true for all of us unless we are incredibly intentional to find ways to step out of the echo chamber. We don't really have a choice in that one unless we decide we're going to act in different ways so that we get out of the echo chamber and hear some new voices. Now, it's got to be some time for some good news. Almost every survey still says that 70% or so of the country claims to be Christian or at least favorable toward Christianity. 70%. And most of those who would say that they're not Christian still have a favorable view of Jesus. Just do the math. No political party has anywhere close to a majority of the country. So that tells you that there are people who love Jesus, or at least are very favorably inclined toward Jesus, in both parties. It takes something bigger than the gap to bridge the gap, and we know who that person is. That person is Jesus himself. He's bigger than the gap, and he can help us bridge this gap. See, we have an enemy, but the enemy is not the other mammal. The enemy is never another person. The text that Joanna read from Ephesians says that our battle is not against flesh and blood. It's against principalities and rulers. It's against the coronavirus. It's not against people. And even if there are people who are espousing things that the Bible would call evil, and there are. Certainly there are people espousing things that that God would say are evil. Even if we were to see those people as enemies, which we're not supposed to, how does Jesus say we're supposed to treat our enemies? Even if they were the enemy, we would love them and pray for them. So the other side is not the enemy, especially for those of us who grew up Lutheran and maybe memorized parts of the Small Catechism. We need to pull back out the explanation to the Eighth Commandment. The Eighth Commandment says, "You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." And here's what Luther says that means. We should fear and love God, that we may not deceitfully belie, betray, slander, or defame our neighbor, but defend him, think and speak well of him, and put the best construction on everything he says. When has that ever happened in politics? Once. Has it ever happened once in politics? We need to be the solution. We are called to be salt and light and to put that commandment into practice. There are several elephant favorites that I think Jesus favors. There are several donkey favorites that I think Jesus favors. And so very quickly, just to put some flesh to that statement, I'm going to take three of each and quickly show that I believe Jesus is in favor of all of them. He didn't sign up for one side or the other. So here's my first question. Does Jesus favor religious liberty or caring for the poor? The answer would be yes. It's not one or the other. It's both. Religious liberty, free will, is built into creation right from the very beginning. And the way Jesus ministered, the way he walked through his life, everybody had freedom to respond or not respond. Religious liberty is built into the way that God has ordered and constructed the world. He's in favor of it. It's both creation and redemption. But on the other side tends to talk about caring for the poor. Well, Jesus was poor. That statement, "the poor you will always have with you," it doesn't mean that we don't need to care for the poor. It means we should always be in close proximity with the poor. The poor we should always be with is what Jesus is saying. So it's not one or the other. It's both. Religious liberty can't be a passion just for the elephants. And caring for the poor can't be talking points for only the donkeys. Next question. Does Jesus value the life of the unborn or the life of the refugee and immigrant? Yes, he does. We shouldn't have to choose which one to value. Now, that very odd passage that I asked Joanna to read earlier from Exodus, I chose it just because within one chapter, you've got verses that talk about the value of the unborn life, and it's treated the same as the value of the life that's born. It's the eye for eye, tooth for tooth passage, and it's talking about the value of the baby before the baby's even born. And then in the very next chapter, it's talking about the value of the life of the foreigners, the refugees, who are the most vulnerable people on the planet. Well, unborn, because unless somebody cares for them, they don't have a chance to survive. But a pretty close second would be refugees. Those who are forced to flee because of the unstable conditions where they live. We shouldn't have to choose between which one of those we should care for. It's not one or the other. All human life matters to God. We should not be put in a position where we have to pick which one matters more. Third question, does Jesus value marriage or does he value racial equality? The answer is yes. Even though each side has picked their favorite, Jesus favors them both. Jesus defines marriage in the New Testament. He talks about how marriage is defined. The New Testament consistently lifts up a sexual ethic as between one man and one woman for life. Now, our country has taken some moves on that statement and gone beyond what the Bible has to say. And I, for one, don't see any movement toward that turning back the other direction anytime soon. So what does that mean for us as followers of Jesus? Well, it means let's follow Jesus, who the Bible says was full of grace and truth. Not one or the other, it's both. So we can hold to truth, but to be full of grace means we move toward other people, not away from them. Grace and truth, not one or the other. So Jesus values marriage, we can as well. Racial inequality is a real thing. And it's not just in the history books. It's a real issue when you look at incarceration rates, when you look at the access to education, the numbers do not lie. It's not even close. Righting the wrongs of the past cannot be the concern of only half of the nation. All of us need to care about some of these things that Jesus himself cares about. I believe Jesus supports elephant Republican priorities of religious liberty, caring for the unborn, sanctity of marriage. I believe Jesus supports donkey Democrat priorities of caring for the poor, protecting immigrants and refugees, righting the wrongs of racial inequity. It's not one or the other. It's both. So in our remaining couple of minutes, how are some ways that we can truly be salt and light for the culture around us? These are pretty simple, but we haven't been doing them. So we need to start. Here's the first one. Make friends. The church is uniquely equipped for this because in most congregations, I would bet money, there are donkeys and elephants in the same congregation. Now, one of them may be incognito. They may be in hiding and you may not know that they're there, but I'll bet you money they are. There are people on the other side of the platform that we already know and love, but because we've done so poorly at talking about politics, we don't even know it. For certain, if that's not true in this congregation, the John 17 weekend that's happening right now is filled with donkeys and elephants, and we love one another dearly. When you can put a face on the other party, you're much less likely to firebomb them. That's the place that this has to start. Second, we need to just humble ourselves. Instead of dinner time conversation rule of never talk politics or religion, we need to do exactly the opposite of that. That is the place that we need to talk politics and religion, is around a dinner table or something like it. And start with a question like this: help me understand. Help me understand what's important to you. Start with a statement like this: I don't have all the answers. I know what I value, but I'd love to hear what you value. And then put the best possible construction on the other person's motives. I'm convinced that even those who are diametrically opposed to things that we would say biblically we hold very, very close to be true, they probably have some reasonable motives behind many of their beliefs. We need to learn how to talk. Third, accept anger, but exercise self-control. I would argue that there's probably never been a significant change in the country over something that was wrong without somebody having gotten angry about the thing that was wrong in the first place. Do not hear all of this conversation as saying you shouldn't hold convictions or you shouldn't hold them strongly. I'm not saying that at all. We need to hold our convictions strongly, and we need to understand why we hold them. But at the same time, the enemy is never the other person. So we can hold our convictions and be full of grace at the same time. And then finally, we just need to build a bigger tribe. Our tribes are too small. The kingdom of God is our ultimate loyalty. If we could just see ourselves like passengers on a plane, blowing up the other side of the aisle is a really bad idea. Because the whole plane goes down if you do that. Well, that's where we are. Blowing up the other side of the aisle is not a good move. Jesus prayed for unity and love for one another as his last prayer before heading to the cross. So let's start there, building political bridges with people we already know and love who live on the other side of the aisle. You are the salt of the earth. If salt loses its saltiness, what hope is there? You are the light of the world. Let's reflect Jesus, the light, in all that we do and say.